So we're live. This is the Web Technologies Hangout on Air. It's a time for us to get together on Fridays remotely and talk about web technologies. I'm Jonathan Belcher. I work on WooCommerce.com at Automattic. Andrew?
I'm Andrew Duffy. I also work at Automattic. I'm a JavaScript engineer and I work primarily on WordPress.com.
Okay. And Peyton?
Same thing.
And then Ben's here, not here. He may join us in a touch. Oh, good, Ben. He unmuted, but so he's here, not here. He's currently babysitting a deploy. So the first thing I wanted to talk about that came up this week was somebody posted in a private channel and said, hey, what are your themes for Sublime? And then, of course, I posted my Atom setup. And then Ben actually posted his. And I said, hey, you know, why not give this a try? And so I switched over to his, which was just two of the stock dark themes. But he also mentioned the Fira code font, and that font comes with ligatures. And I thought that the ligatures were absolutely amazing. And so when you type equals equal equals, it actually makes it one character in your editor, and as well as like arrow functions and all sorts of things like that. So like, I highly recommend going to check out the Fira code font and the ligatures.
I feel like, wouldn't that get sort of confusing because you type three characters to make it a triple equal, but then you only backspace once? Does that, like, I feel like I would get confused sort of with that distinction. Is it not? Do you get used to it, I'm guessing?
I think it might actually be three characters that are just joined together.
Yeah, but to delete them, would you have to press backspace three times?
Give me a second to go check.
I think you would press backspace three times is my guess.
Backspace three times. So yes, not confusing. I've only been using it for a day, but it's definitely like, I really liked it. It was very confusing at first, like typing the equal, 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 and then it transforms into something else. Or I opened up a piece of code that I was very familiar with and it looked very foreign. But yeah, so deleting, it requires three deletions to get back out.
Sounds like yes.
Making me think of a font I saw recently, but I'm not going to be able to find it. I'll keep looking.
Cool. So then going down through some of the items in the list, I saw Gmail is going to restrict JavaScript file attachments starting soonish. So I thought that was like super interesting that now I guess people were using JavaScript files as exploits to run in the browser.
Huh. How would that work though? Because it's not, I assume when you send it as an attachment, it's not just running when you open the email.
Yeah, and like, I guess somewhere in Gmail, it would have to eval it or, yeah. And like double clicking on a JavaScript file, I guess on most computers would open it in a text editor.
I think it used to be, like, I remember in old Windows versions that you could just double click and it would execute the JavaScript. Maybe that's what they're concerned about, but I feel like, yeah, most modern operating systems, although I don't really know if that's the case in Windows even today, because I don't use Windows, but I feel like they shouldn't execute it if they are.
Yeah, the article or the blog post from Google didn't really explain why they were doing it, but they, yeah.
I was reading some of the Reddit comments about this, and it's interesting to see the people that would be affected by this, because, you know, what's the impact of this? And I think it was, you know, you'd have people at agencies or freelancers that were sending files back and forth between clients, and sort of like the old style FTP upload, you know, send over the JavaScript file, upload it over FTP, and now they're going to have to zip it up. Although I think Gmail is pretty smart about zip files, so they might even block it that way.
I don't know. Yeah, I was going to say just zip it up and send it over, but maybe they are smart enough for that.
I think you can look at the contents of a zip through Gmail, if I recall correctly. I don't know if they would then take it a step further, and if they detect that there's a JavaScript file, you know, strip that out of the attachment as well.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to test and see if that works, because I mean, they run some sort of virus scan on files that are sent through, I believe. And it'd be interesting to see if it runs it on files within a zip. I don't know. Be worth testing out.
By the way, I found that font I was thinking of. It's Operator Mono, which, if you haven't seen it, is pretty awesome. You can find pictures of it in lots of places, but basically it uses ligatures and cursive to make JavaScript and CSS a lot easier. Well, I don't know, you know, it's subjective, but it makes it very, scroll down to the place where it actually has some code. That's where it looks interesting. Yeah, that there's like a black box somewhere of code on that page.
So it uses a little bit of cursive as well. Yeah. As...
So like, for example, I wish I could just show, maybe I can just show a screenshot. Can I do that? Let's see. Screen share.
Well, it's kind of interesting because I see in one case it makes the S into a cursive, and then in another it doesn't make an S.
Yeah, because it's aware of, if you're using it in say Atom, which is what this example is, it's aware of the type of thing that you're currently looking at. So for example, in this example, it's highlighting JSX, and for attributes, the properties of the props that are being sent to the JSX to create class, it uses cursive for those, but then everything else is not cursive. Anyway, I don't know. I haven't actually ended up using it yet, but I like tons of code screenshots I've been seeing lately, particularly out of people like Guillermo and what's his name? Just web developers that I admire. They're all using this font, so it keeps coming back up to me.
Wow, yeah, it is. It, like, if you look at my screen.
Yeah, there it is.
Is it? Okay. Oh, sorry.
Wow, infinite.
Sorry. I need my dual screens for this. So the cursive here on the class name, that's awesome. Right here as well. Yeah. I think I'm going to switch. Wow, that's really nice. I like that.
Yeah, the only reason I haven't is because I use Vim, and so I was like, well, I'm going to have to figure out how to make that work. And so, though I just found an article about it, so we'll see.
Oof, this one's maybe a little too cursive for me. Okay.
It also $200.
Is it not free?
No.
Ooh. Not free. Yeah.
Let's go to the bottom of the page.
$200,
wow. Seems weird that I would be seeing it so much if you had to pay for it.
I have one way to respond to that, and that is yar.
There's this actually mentions Fira code. Okay, it comes full circle. Here's a link. An alternative to Operator Mono. I guess Dan Abramov used Operator Mono. That would have sold it. So So this person says, here's how you can sort of remake it a little bit. I don't know how accurate that is or not. Anyway.
Cool. Worth a chance to play with.
Something to look around at. Ah, $200.
So Adam has a styles sheet that you can just drop in styles for your code.
Oh, yeah. Did you? Yeah.
I've never really given Adam a serious chance, so I don't. I'm a Sublime text advocate mostly.
So a lot of people have been saying, oh, Adam's really, really slow and it doesn't do the things that I needed to do. I found that, yes, it was slow 2 years ago when they released it, but there's been it's sped up a lot. And I mean, I came from Sublime, so maybe I just got used to it being slow, Adam. But I found that a lot of the extensions and all of the different code highlighters and linters and all that stuff works really, really well with Atom. Whereas I remember having a lot of issues in Sublime. But that course could have been because that was 2 years ago when linting wasn't as big of a thing.
Yeah.
The next thing I have on my list is I dropped it in the group chat, is the Zoe Page is now working at Mozilla and working as a web compatibility engineer. And so I found that really interesting. I didn't know that they had people at Mozilla that specifically work on web compatibility.
What do they mean by web compatibility then?
What is a web compat bug? And so these are the people that work on web compatibility bugs. And it's, if it's in more than three common browsers, please report the bug to the website. So the idea is that it's a bug that exists in some browsers, but not others. So it goes back to the traditional, like, you have to do a thing a special way in IE6, you know, with padding on two sides because it'll blow things up, or I don't remember the exact, but the idea is that all the browsers are slightly different, and the job here is to make things more compatible across browsers.
Interesting.
I think that's awesome.
So is that specific? Is her role specific then to how that would impact Mozilla, or is she sort of an advocate across all of these platforms then?
Yeah, I think that, well, they work at Mozilla, and so it doesn't say anything specifically about working on Mozilla. So I think in general, it's probably a lot of it is triaging bugs and make sure the right people on all the different web vendors know of the bugs. But it doesn't say anything specific about Mozilla in here.
Yeah.
Which I think is awesome.
Sounds sort of similar to John David Dalton, who's the author of Lodash, from what I understood when he did a podcast interview at one point. His role at Microsoft is sort of similar as an open source advocate on behalf of Microsoft for Microsoft Edge to make sure that the leading libraries in the JavaScript ecosystem work well. I think his role is primarily on, you know, making sure it works well on Microsoft Edge and reporting bugs, but just sort of a similar idea with trying to make sure that browser compatibility is up to par.
Yeah, and the DevRel team at Chrome, on the Chrome team, they do a very similar thing as well. So certainly interesting stuff. It's just amazing that that these companies do all these things that benefit the entire community. And I think without Mozilla, without Google and Microsoft pushing these browsers forward, like, it'd be really tough for all of us to have jobs.
Just think what the web would be like without Facebook right now, which is such a weird thing to say, but like, their engineers have really pushed forward JavaScript in ways that, well, I mean, in some ways that's a biased statement because they just hire people who are brilliant, who've already been pushing the web forward. But it's true.
Yeah, I think actually this is something maybe I don't recall what the link is, but it was a listing of popular repositories on GitHub based off of not just stars but also contribution activity, and it was interesting to look at the top projects and how the influence of having paid engineers work on projects full time. And in fact, I found it particularly interesting because we were on the list for Calypso, was one of the top 10 projects on there based off of both stars and contribution activity. But I can't recall off the top of my head, but there was definitely a bias towards these big companies that are investing into open source projects.
I also remember an article from back in the day, and I don't have a link for it, but it was somebody put out a conspiracy theory that all of these large companies, Google, Microsoft, Facebook, they developed their own frameworks and libraries so that engineers would use those frameworks and libraries and thus like sort of silo them in and be able to hire those people. So by creating React, Facebook has created engineers that specifically work on their stack as opposed to, you know, just using something like Angular and then, you know, having to share those developers across. I think it was a bit of a harebrained conspiracy, but I found it interesting. There may be an element of truth in there. Sorry, I'm looking for a link. Okay, so I posted a link to CSSTricks.com and it says, let's look at 50 interesting CSS properties and values. And I thought it might be interesting to like grab a couple out of here that that you might have found interesting. I'm going to go ahead and start with Flex. Because I know we've all probably been using it, but I hadn't started using Flex seriously until like sometime last year, and that was because of browser compatibility issues, and I just couldn't use it. But once we dropped, I think it was IE9, I was able to. Yeah, Flex requires IE10 and up, I believe it is. So that was like super awesome. I love Flex. I have found that on the browser compatibility side, that Safari does things a little bit different than Chrome. And I got all the way to the end of like reworking an entire like view, and then I looked at it in Safari, and it was like, sorry, your job is not done yet. And then I went over to Edge in IE11, and it was real bad.
Yeah, that's always been the issue. Well, and because I think there's an entire repository on GitHub, I'll have to find the link, that's just Flex bugs. And there's one in particular I always run into with IE11 around the Flex Spaces unit. When you use the Flex shorthand and you do like Flex 110 or something, that won't work because IE11.
Oh, you're breaking up.
Oh, sorry. If you use the Flex shorthand, like Flex 110, it won't work in IE11 because of some bug where it expects the Flex basis part of that shorthand to have a unit. So you'd have to say 110% specifically for IE11. And that's always been, like, Flex is awesome. It's just, it's like knowing all of these bugs and just how to use it effectively. I think the simple cases are simple, and it's so powerful, but just knowing how to use the power of it. Like specific examples I can think of recently is wanting to, you know, fill up a whole space except a little bit at the end and starting to understand some of the individual parts of what flex is. You know, you have flex grow, flex shrink, and flex basis. And I think a lot of people overlook what those are even doing. They just say like, oh, you know, 110 or, you know, like 210, and not understanding, you know, how to set a basis for one particular element within a flex container, for example, and how that works. But once you do understand it, it's pretty amazing the things that you can do with it. It's relevant to bring up too, because I don't know if this is the reason you brought it up, but Bootstrap, the new version coming out, drops support for, or it uses Flexbox for its grid system, which is a big deal. Because
really, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. The other bug in IE is like, I think it's min width. So if you use min width with flex basis, I believe it is, it just blows. Just blows out.
I actually did. I ran into
this. Min height. Yeah, it's one of the two.
I actually ran into this very issue in IE11 with, it was just the width operator. It was trying to make it so it would be like, you had a centered element in a, like a three column layout that was the left and the right could grow. And so I was trying to get it where it was like 50%, 50%, and then whatever's left over for the middle chunk. And it was IE11, it might be this very same issue that was giving me a hard time, not realizing that you'd have to use the flex basis style in order to make that work.
Oh, cool. So Andrew posted the link to the flex bugs, and it's Philip Walton that on GitHub that has a repository called Flex Bugs. Flex super awesome. I'm super excited about it. So another one that I've been using a lot more is Calc. And so you can actually do calculations within your CSS, which allows for allows you to, you know, put in some variable values, which is sort of nice because, like, sometimes you want to do something like 100% minus one EM. So you can mix your units, and once we get variables, it'll be super super powerful because then, you know, it can update live rather than it'll update live. So
I've always found with like Calc seems and it sounds really powerful, but every time I've used it, I sort of get this sense that I shouldn't be using it, that there are better alternatives. And Flexbox comes to mind because even in your example, you know, if you're saying 100% minus one EM, presumably you're trying to like make space for something on one edge of the box, which is what Flex is particularly well suited for. So I always start with Calc, and then I end up realizing maybe Calc's not the best way to be doing this. And I always wonder, and the same thing with Flexbox, I've wondered how the perform, you know, we don't think much about CSS performance, but what is the performance like of Calc? I remember when Flexbox first came out and people started using it for layouts, there were all these benchmarks around how Flexbox is just slow in comparison to just floating elements around the page. But you know, now we're seeing Bootstrap, you know, fully embrace it. Is that just as a simplification, you know, because floating elements is kind of a pain to get right? Or is it, you know, are we now at the point where the performance issues are negligible, on par with what the alternatives are? And then, you know, you throw grid into the mix, which I honestly don't know much about at all. I've not used it, but why does grid exist when we have flex?
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. Everybody I talk to that knows that has used and looked at and is working on the spec for Grid, they all seem to think that it is the, you know, the greatest thing that has ever existed. And so I really, I just don't have time to look at it or understand it because I can't, I'm not going to be able to use it for a while. And, but yeah, I don't know why we need Grid when we have some of these, the newer tools with Flex.
It could be. I mean, it's the same, maybe the same thing with, you know, you could do Grid systems with Float. You know, Float worked and, you know, whatever, you know, it's a little tricky. And it's the same thing now with Flex. You can do grids and you can have these columns layouts. And it might just be semantics and simplifying particular use cases. So columned layouts have existed on sites since forever. And, you know, and it's evolved how you implement those over time. And maybe Grid is just sort of a simplification in a more semantic way of defining the layout of a page that way. Though more and more pages are one column anyways. So do we need to be spending all, I know that we'll need columns for other things outside of just page layouts, but it's funny to see how the design has evolved where columns are increasingly rare because of responsive implications.
I think that's been the biggest thing for me with Flex is not having to add a million media queries just to make things work. Is that like with Flex, you know, and being able to flex direction row and then saying, okay, wrap, you know, flex wrap and wrapping things down, and like that just made it so much easier. And you have so much more control over since floats, but.
Right. Yeah, where you could just change the flex direction and on a large screen, you know, you could, it was just one style attribute. You'd change it from, I always get them confused, but from row to column and it would collapse nicely. And I remember one of the very first things I ever did with flex years ago was having a sidebar on the left side on a large device, and then on the bottom of the page on a phone or a smaller viewport device, and how the order property in Flexbox would let you sort of rearrange elements in the DOM that way.
So I did, I'm trying to remember how I did what it was. So I created a Polymer element. It was a list of things. And I used the order attribute to resort the list based on a dropdown. And I was blown away at how easy that was. It was like, yes. Like I didn't have, I just let the browser handle all of the reordering of all the different things. I didn't have to pull the DOM out and reorder it and then stick the DOM back. I just changed the order and it just automatically changed the order of the list.
I feel like you don't see that. You don't see order that much. I don't know. I don't know if the use cases are few and far between, but. Oh, it's interesting that it's on the list. I'm looking over and I'm seeing orders on this list of interesting properties.
Yeah. Another one I did for ordering, but I didn't use order, but I had like an image and text. And so it was like text, image, image, text, text, image. And so when I went to mobile, I needed I wanted the image on top and then the text underneath, and they were all in different order. So then I did nth child, and so like I forget how you do it, but like all the odd ones, I did flex wrap reverse, and then all the even ones, I did flex wrap just normal, and it worked right away, and I was like, wow, that would have been so much more difficult, like not using this, so. It's fun when you have those moments.
It's kind of, I think it's really a browser compatibility issue might be contributing to a lot of why you don't see some of these properties being used. And even something like nth child, which I think even in IE has pretty good support, maybe even back to 9 or 8. but you know, you see people just using, because I remember it was like last child. Last child would work in IE7 or something, but not first child. And how long that stuck with me over time is preposterous to think about now. And with JavaScript, we have, you know, we can write ES6 because we transpile it. And to a lesser extent, we have that with CSS and auto prefixer, but there are certain things that you just can't really, I don't know, maybe the tools can't transpile these things very well from like falling back from flex to float, because there are probably things that you couldn't have done before flex. And so maybe the fact that it's 2017 and it's a big deal that Bootstrap is embracing Flexbox, it's a little sad to think about that the browsers lagging behind has prevented us from doing this. But nowadays, with browsers being greenfield, I think that's the term, where they auto update themselves, hopefully this won't be too much of an issue moving forward. I'm sure it will be, but one can hope.
Well, I mean, I'll say it every single time. Like, once we can get rid of IE11, and Microsoft wants to do that as quickly as possible, you know, we're in evergreen world, and so as long as all the browsers get it, then you can use it, and that's exciting. But I do remember the days of like a year or two, maybe 3 years after dropping like IE6 support or IE7, I remember saying to a more junior developer, "It's like, no, don't do that. Like, you can't do that. You, like, that'll break in, you know, IE6." And the developer just looking at me going, "Wait, what is IE6? It's like, and I'm like, "Oh man, I just dated myself so bad."
Yeah, I still can't use trailing commas because of that. Just like, I have like a twitch if I see trailing commas.
Or like, remember console log?
Yeah.
Console log. Yeah, it was console log that would break. And that was IE8. I think it was 8. So if you didn't add a polyfill for console log, it would, you know, your JavaScript would just die. I mean, you shouldn't have console logs in your production code anyways, but still. That's a fun one.
Total sidebar on the note of dropping IE11. I noticed recently downloading the Edge virtual machine from Microsoft's website that Windows 10, out of the box, Windows 10, or at least with the virtual machine, out of the box, Windows 10 includes both IE11 and Microsoft Edge, which almost seemed to me like a message from Microsoft that they're not fully committed to dropping it quite yet, or that they needed that fallback to say, "Oh, it doesn't work in Edge. Well, you have IE11. You know, try it in there and see if it works."
So, one of the biggest problems with dropping these legacy browsers are there were a ton of enterprise applications that were built specifically in IE browsers and use IE-specific APIs that don't work. You know, I mean, you don't see it much these days, but like most banks 5 years ago, you had to use IE. You couldn't use Firefox or Chrome, and or things would be like severely broken. And I think that's the reason that IE11 is still in the latest version of Windows, is because corporate and military, you know, corporate and government like falls behind, and they need time to rewrite those applications. Now, like bundling it with it, that sort of, it helps them sell Windows, but it doesn't send a strong enough signal to corporations saying, "Hey, rewrite your apps because this is going away soon."
Yeah, I've almost seen the opposite lately, or I saw some story about how in Chrome, I don't know if this was a new feature, but how in Chrome for enterprise customers, they had the option to be able to fix the version to a specific version of Chrome and prevent the auto updates from going through, and how that would impact, or just, you know, I think all, as much as we can, it should be encouraged that you shouldn't be targeting web apps towards a specific browser or browser version. And when browser vendors like Microsoft or Google give these escape hatches for enterprises to continue doing that, it's sort of, yeah, you know, you're sort of giving them what they need, but at the same time, you're not encouraging them from rewriting or making their apps more compatible with across browsers, which is kind of what they should be doing.
Yeah. So back to that, the speaking to the junior developer who was just playing with some stuff, that same developer around the same time had this bug where he couldn't figure out why he had a global variable that would just, the global variable just kept popping up, and he wasn't creating that variable anywhere. And then I looked at the HTML, and he had an ID in his HTML. And I was like, that's where your variable is coming from. And I always love to bring this up in conversations with other developers, because it's not something that people use a lot, and it's not something that people know of, but it can really, really bite you if you're not aware that browsers automatically create variables from your IDs.
Really?
Is that still the case? I seem to recall this, but is it still the case? Do you know?
I'd have to look, but I mean, this was like a year and a half, 2 years ago. So yeah.
I remember one that quite possibly still is an issue that's sort of related to this is Chrome, at least, would have a global event object. And so typically you'd have a on-click handler that would be past the event object and pull it out of there. But in Chrome, you could be you might forget that argument. And in Chrome, it would still work, like event.preventDefault or something would still work, because in the context of the event handler, it has that global. But try to run that on a different browser that doesn't have that same behavior, it would die. And for most of us who are developing in Chrome, unless you think to check another browser, that would bite you.
Yeah, I had a very similar. I had a bug earlier this week that I was, on an event. I was on a browser click. I was doing something, and the attributes of the event in Chrome and Firefox were different. I was using an attribute that didn't exist in Firefox. And I don't know why I used it, but I think it was like, maybe it was source, it wasn't source element. So I switched to source element from something else. And I don't know, I guess I just opened up the object. I was like, okay, I'll use that and move on. And as soon as I tested in Firefox, it broke.
One like so. That as well is a key and key code. You go to, I use MDN, the Mozilla Developer Network, for, looking at their docs, and you go and you look at key code, and at the top it gives you this scary message saying, don't use key code, it's deprecated, use key instead. But then you look at key and you look at the browser support, and you realize that the browser support isn't there for all browsers. You're sort of stuck in this, what do I use? Should I use key? Should I use key code? I'll have to eventually use key, but for now, it would break some browsers to use it.
Yeah, that gets that particular one gets a lot of fun too, because I actually filed a bug against the Chrome timeline, the Chrome DevTools, because I don't use QWERTY. I use COLMAC for my keyboard layout, and timeline has this thing where you can use WASD, the WASD keys to navigate in the timeline. Well, on my keyboard, I have WARS, not WASD. Right, so that doesn't work. So they changed it so that it now uses key code, I think, or whatever the replacement was. So there's one that's the actual hardware identifier for the key, which is placement on the keyboard. There's one that identifies the actual key that was pressed. So depending on what you want, like if you're doing a game, you want to know physical location. You don't really care what the key is. But if you're doing like you know, input validation, you need to know what the actual character was. Yeah, that stuff gets gross really fast. Browsers do not have good support for it.
And especially because it's not something you can fall back to, or, you know, it's not something you can drop in pretty easily because they're very different. You know, you say key equals enter, or you say key code equals whatever it's 15 or something.
Yeah. And then you get into like a lot of folks, especially in not, you know, Latin language speaking countries, use special key combos to generate certain keys. So you have to hit like two keys at the same time, or shift alt 9 or something. Or even back to back keys. So you hit two keys in a sequence and that generates one character. If you want to capture that kind of a stuff and validate it, you can't do it with key code at all. You have to wait until the actual character shows up. So it's, yeah, it's not fun.
Good times.
Yeah. Yep.
All right.
You look at it, you're like, oh, this will be easy. And then like a month later, you're still fighting with it.
Yeah. Anybody ever done stuff with time zones? Same
run
thing.
Away. Just run away.
Just run.
Yeah.
Especially JavaScript, yeah.
Well, Swatch I had one. We were getting times from, you know, times as Unix codes from the server. Then because it had a real world implication, it was like, in my previous two roles, I dealt with the same problem. It's, do we use the time zone of the user, of the browser, or do you use the time zone of the location where that thing, that real world thing exists? Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, good times.
Not to get too specific, but in the context of WordPress and the WordPress REST API with the dates that they provide, it becomes even more confusing because those are offset by the specific website's time zone. So you have to, but when you parse it into the current user's browser, it obviously translates it into their browser time zone. So now you're trying to deal with how do you offset it from the site's time zone relative to the user's current browser time zone into something meaningfully, then yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's not fun.
Yeah, and you don't know if the browser's time zone maps are actually up to date.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in the US, it's not such an issue because our time zone lines don't move a whole lot. But if you've got a user in India or Russia or some of the other countries out there where the time zone boundaries move around a little bit or have moved in the recent past, if they haven't updated, then their time zone conversion is going to be wrong. It's not going to be congruent with ours.
So I think for me, the biggest one was the going over like a day. So 1 a.m. Eastern Standard Time is yesterday Pacific Standard Time. And so that was the biggest problem because I was grouping events into days. And so, we had like we would group those things and the DOM implications of like moving one from a previous day from one day to another based on, I had nightmares for months on that. So moving on to my favorite thing that I've seen in like months is this, like, one sec.
That's brilliant.
That's very little code to be able to achieve that too.
Yeah.
Nice. Is that just CSS? Yeah.
A little bit of JS to move the thing around, but
to do the reveal.
Yep.
Still confused how that works.
Radial gradient. Oh, it's a transparent radial gradient.
Oh, I see. Oh, so it's like a overlay of like a black.
Yeah, it's the reverse of what you think it is.
Yeah,
you're moving the whole thing around.
I was talking and I didn't unmute myself, but the reason this is really cool is because it's using the CSS variables. Oh, I don't want to mess up the code. And so you can see dash dash cursor X and Y. And so those are initially set up here, but over in the JavaScript, it goes and it says document.style set property cursor X. And then it sets the actual location of the mouse. So it's changing in the JavaScript. It's changing the variable in the CSS in real time. Cool. So up until now, we haven't been able to do this. And the CSS was completely static. But now, you would have to add a class or remove a class to affect that change. And so now you could conceivably give inside of a class that is attached to an element, you could give it a CSS variable and then change it from hidden to shown without having to remove and add classes.
Or cycle the color or change the size or.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's neat.
Yeah. So I don't know. I get super excited about CSS variables. And again, there's polyfills are awesome. Polyfills are really awesome, but there's no way to polyfill that because I'm sure it could be polyfilled, but it's just, the polyfill would be so complex, it's not worth the time to, where the performance hit to do it. So once we get rid of IE11, we're good to go.
I wonder how you would implement this currently.
You can change CSS dynamically with JavaScript. You just can't change a variable, so you'd have to change everything that relied on it.
Right.
I think that would work.
Yeah, or it could just be one giant panel that you're sort of shifting around on top of the page, as long as the browser has the radial gradient support. Or SVG masks, that's kind of what I was thinking, but those are fun.
Yeah. Woof. Yeah, it'd be much more difficult. So another link is WebGL2 lands in Firefox, and that is pretty awesome. I Dave Voyle is a he's dev relations for Microsoft, and he does a lot of Edge. Developer relations here in Philadelphia, and he talked about the WebGL in Edge, and he showed some pretty darn amazing things, and it completely blows me away the performance implications of being able to use that in the browser. We can do things that we wouldn't have even thought of doing before. Like you could do full games in the browser and not use Flash.
Is there these are those sort of things that you always see the really, really cool demos for. But beyond that, are people using these? And if they're not, is that because of browser support or just the use cases aren't there?
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. Again, it's like, do you build to one target? Do you build to Firefox and say, hey, this thing that we've created works, and it works really, really amazingly, but it's only in Firefox.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we're talking about WebGL2. I mean, WebGL1, you don't really see a lot of, so.
Yeah. I'm gonna look at the kit I use.
Just reminds me of what was it? A Chrome Experiments site that had all of these really neat demos, or CodePen demos, those sorts of things.
Yeah. Well, it looks like WebGL is in IE11, Edge, Firefox, Chrome, Safari.
Yeah. I'd like to see something. It's probably not so fantastic these days, but what was that article that was... There was this article published in one of the main publications websites several years ago that used video elements and different clipping styles on text to sort of make the article look amazing, sort of not like a typical website. And I just remember it was such a big deal at the time, and maybe I'll try to find a link here, but it never really, it used all these cool technologies, but it never really got adopted. And I don't know if we're just so early on in this that we've yet to sort of standardize towards these cool technologies, but it just seems they're cool for demos and not really taking hold.
I think that game development is just a really already kind of tense world, because is, you know, we're finally starting to get to the point where a lot of developers are making their games cross-platform. Like on Steam, for example, you see a lot more cross-platform games than there ever used to be. Versus them being Windows only. And I think it's just like, but I mean, GL is a standardized thing. So this, like this opens doors, but I feel like developers and studios have to be like willing to take risks. And it's always like, because there's so much money often behind these, or no money in the case of indie games, that like, it's always, there's so many risks that people, because porting a game sucks.
Yeah. I could see it being revolutionary in the same way that, you know, Google Docs took the idea of a desktop web processor that was traditionally you would install to your Windows machine and moved it onto the web. And it's the same thing with games. Games are, you know, they're typically native applications. And if we're opening up these possibilities to do it on the web and do it cross-platform, that could be revolutionary in that way, for sure.
Does everybody remember that Zelda? It looked like Zelda, but it was like a web demo of like a mini Zelda game that came out for the web. Let me see if I can find it real quick. Browserclub.org.
Oh yeah, and this was a MMO type thing that was also showcasing WebRTC, I think.
I don't remember, but it's like super killer.
Yeah.
Like I was just amazed at like everything that they were able to do in the browser.
Maybe it was WebSockets or WebRTC that they were showcasing here.
Yeah.
And how you would have all of these different people in the same world.
Yeah. It's pretty crazy. There's 24 players, even after like years and years of this being a demo.
Huh.
Another one that I thought was really cool was there was a Minesweeper, Bomberman web game. Yeah, I think this is it.
Game of Bombs.
But it just play as guest. Let's see if it'll. I don't think this is it. There you go. Just like all sorts of craziness. I don't remember how it was played, but yeah. Just like these huge rooms, like multiplayer, and it's just amazing that like they're able to do all this on the web. And I think this used AngularJS, which I thought was really cool.
Huh. Just imagine how much faster it would be without two-way data binding.
Oh, man.
Troll.
So I think the article I was thinking about and mentioning earlier about like cool news articles is this New York Times snowfall and how it used videos. And at the time, that was a new thing, and how that might impact the news publishing on the web. And then, yeah, if you look at it now, it's like, you know, cool videos and floated images and full width news article.
Yeah, I mean, so I think that this is, at the time I remember seeing this as well, it was just like, oh my God, this is amazing. Mm-hmm. And I think we do see some things like this. I don't, but I think it has to be like a very, because this costs a lot of money to produce even today. Like, this isn't an easy thing to like just quickly, you know, throw together via like a, be like an admin screen. You have to have developers that like help you. Ah, maybe you could do that.
Yeah, there's aspects of it, like the parallax effects that are really common these days, or even just video headers and these sorts of things.
Yeah, and where you add these and
yeah,
what's in the slideshow. I guess it wouldn't be that tough.
You see it a lot with, I always, you know, look at the US election. And the
yeah,
really interactive voting results pages that big publishers will create to sort of make it a really neat and live experience. I think, well, sometimes there's a little bit of a pushback on that too, because I think this one, I forget, it was a big one, but they had this like needle on where this election was going, and I just remember it actually, the implementation of it, somebody dug into it, and it was totally random. It was like JavaScript doing this random needle movement that just, it was supposed to be live, but it wasn't really live, but giving readers that impression that it is live is sort of a cool experience, I think. Or is it 538 that had some really neat interactions too?
Yeah, they always have really nice stuff.
But yeah, it's primarily at these big events that you see the money being poured into making cool visuals.